welcome Shreyasi, Dr. Patwardhan, Mohan, and Mayank. It's a privilege to have you all in this particular panel to take the conversation today further on how education of future might look like. To start with, let me just tell you a brief about Dr. Patwardhan. He is the Vice Chairman of University Grants Commission and Professor of Interdisciplinary School of Health Sciences, Savitribai Phule, Pune University. Mayank Kumar is the co-founder and MD of UpGrad. We have Mohan, who is the co-founder, a founder of Great Learning and Vice Chairman of Great Lakes Institute of Management. And we have Shreyasi, who is the co-founder and CEO of Harappa Education. This event is on purpose. So the idea that we have been hearing and learning and listening to have been tales and experiences of how purpose have led different people to achieve what they were seeking. Like we had a lot of part about, you know, what success, what's not, and so on. So I would like really to start off with, you know, you taking us through your journey, telling us, you know, what kind of are the secrets to success, how this organization that you're working with now and the positions that you hold allow you to achieve the purpose that you seek for yourself in this point of time. With this, maybe around 4 to 5 minutes, we can have a conversation on this, and then we would come back to the point, more theme of the panel, which is online education. Can I start with you, Shreyasi?
Sure. Thanks, Ajit, and good afternoon, everyone, and wonderful to be here on a cold Sunday from Delhi. So it's nice to be indoors and doing something productive. Just to begin, I think it's a beautifully titled summit for purpose. And I think if young students and graduates are listening to us, I think it's important to lead a life of purpose. And I think the toughest thing of that is knowing what your purpose is. And you know, the business of purpose is a challenging one. You know, you don't sit under a tree and an apple doesn't fall and you know your purpose. I think you have to do the hard work of discovering your purpose and constantly asking sort of problem solving on yourself as you discover your purpose. And for me, and why I'm here, I feel like I've, as a founder and CEO of Harappa Education, which is an online learning institution, many things have converged in my life for me to be here. And I think there is a very specific purpose. What I do right now is certainly hopefully enabling me to do. I've broadly had a very, very serendipitous journey up to the point that I'm here. You know, I started as a television journalist and then went on to become a business journalist and used to be the editor of a magazine and have written books and things like that. You know, I'm a liberal arts student, so I think for many of your students, and now I'm sort of, I keep saying I'm a non-techie, non-MBA founder, CEO of an online VC-funded business, which itself seems serendipitous, and it's a job that I couldn't have imagined doing when I was studying at Lady Shri Ram College in Delhi, 18 years back. So I think, my one purpose has been, certainly, which has helped me, is to be led by curiosity and a little bit of courage and you know, be sort of, you know, excited about the future. And I think when I was starting Harappa along with my co-founder 3 years back, I actually did something which I now actually encourage a lot of young people to do, is write a personal vision statement for yourself. You know, we go to websites of companies and of institutions, and there is the purpose and a mission and a vision. And it sounds a little bit, you know, awkward to do that for yourself, and, you know, think that much about yourself also seems a little bit narcissistic. But I think it has really helped me, and I actually condensed that purpose, and that sentence has really helped me become an entrepreneur over the last 3 years, because I was at a crossroads in my career 3-4 years back, figuring out should I continue my life in journalism and media or do something a little bit more entrepreneurial, because I've been covering entrepreneurship as a journalist. And that personal vision statement was, I want to have the recognition of having built something of scale and impact. And the three key words being recognition, scale, and impact. And I think all those, and that has become a really great framework to evaluate what I do. And I think even putting a word like recognition was a tough one, because you have to say, listen, I don't want to be a hidden unsung hero doing work in you know, some, and there are so many amazing people like that, but that's not for me. So there is a little, you know, confession of your ego to say that if I do hard work and if I create something meaningful, I should be recognized for it, whether it's being on the Purpose Summit at Flame or in other ways. I think, of course, scale and impact very critically, both for obviously living, you know, life beyond yourself and it having a meaning. But more importantly, and I always say this, especially for young women, is entrepreneurship of scale, so that I have the potential to create personal wealth for myself. And I would love for young women to own that ambition. So Harappa seems to me to be a great way, and it's completely linked to the personal purpose that I have in my life of scale, impact, and recognition.
Thank you. I think it's really nice to, you know, for you to be, you knowing what exactly and those three things. And, you know, I agree with you. Maybe to tell that, yes, I want to be famous, I want to be recognized, is something that we don't do for a long point of time. Because, you know, maybe that is not one of the normal, usual aspects to agree to. With this, I would want to come to Dr. Patwardhan. And if you could share with us what has been your driving purpose. It's been an exciting, interesting journey. And how, you know, I think you are at the forefront of an organization which has such a huge impact on education in India. So if you could take us through your personal journey and, you know, then how this organization allows you at this point of time, this role allows you and gets you to kind of work towards your purpose. Sir, I would want you.
Thank you, Sajit. See, basically, I am a teacher. I have been a professor at the university, as you said, and my purpose was really to find what is the purpose of the education, you know? And that is why I like the title of this summit, and so I am here. You know? Because we really confuse between what. Is the purpose of education. And I feel that when I was no choice, we always talk about student-centric education, but this whole system is completely student unfriendly, I would say. Because we are not giving any choice to students. I did not get any choice. If I want to take admission, I have to decide. I have to go to science, arts, or engineering, medicine. When I go to college, I get a prospectus. I have to buy actually prospectus. And then I am told that these are the courses. This is the duration. I don't know why they have decided that duration and who decided that duration. So 3 years, 4 years, whatever. If I don't complete it in that time, I am stamped as failure. And I have no option even to think, you know, means I am given some kind of a curriculum, syllabus, and that syllabus I have to follow blindly. I have to really struggle hard to get notes at that time. Now I don't need to. I also get question bank, and top of it, we don't stop even by giving question bank. We get ready-made answers, model answers, so-called model answers. And I am evaluated based on how best I am able to reproduce the answers which teachers have told me. I think this is completely outdated system. And this is not student-centric. So UGC, as you know, is a regulatory body. And we are managing more than 1,000 universities. More than 1,000 universities, not managing really, but overseeing the quality of education in these universities and more than 45,000 colleges. So it's a huge network. And when I joined UGC, I thought that I must use this opportunity to develop a student-centric system. So just yesterday, if you see on the UGC website, we have put on a new regulation for ABC or Academic Bank of Credit. That was my dream project. No. So now students are able to really choose, pick and choose any subject of their own choice and get degree of their own choice and not necessarily what is forced on them. So student is able to actually design her own degree. This is a major change that has happened in the system, and we have broken boundaries. So we are not now making student to stay only at one place. Lady Shriram, Shreyasi, you were there. You never had opportunity to look at whether some other college teachers are doing good job and you want to go there. No. But now you can do that. You know, you can go to not only ladies, your own college, you can go to any other college, not in Delhi, but you can go to maybe Kerala and learn Kerala martial art career. But you know, this is what this will bring in. And couple of more changes we have made. For example, recently we have done, because today there is no distinction between what is classroom-based teaching, what is online teaching, what is distance education. These are all getting, terms are getting obsolete and outdated, you know. So as a first step, we have combined the regulation of distance and online, and we are trying to go aggressively by use of technology. So that was my second part, which I tried to do. That was my purpose, you know, to bring in more technology in education. And as Mayan could remember, you know, when I was in Manipal, we did started at effort right in 2006. But things are changing, and this is what my in short purpose was, to transform the current practices of education and liberate student, you know, and bring in technology more to empower them to learn what they want to learn, and stop getting forced by anybody, you know, as to what they should and what they should not. Thank you.
Lovely. I think that this dream project of yours is going to be an opportunity for students around India to be, you know, having this kind of a flexibility and this kind of a choice. And I'm sure that, you know, in years to come, this is something that a lot of people are going to look back and say that, you know, this had a huge impact. We at FLEME definitely have been looking at NEP and many others, which I would want to bring into conversation later on, and are thrilled in some of these changes that we are seeing at this point of time. Going ahead, if I can request Mohan to, you know, take us through your journey and your goals, your keys to success, how is purpose defined it? And, you know, how your current organization or organizations, you know, that you're involved in, two very important posts as well, beyond, you know, a few of which I know. So that would be lovely to kind of know your journey.
Yeah. Thank you, Sajid. First of all, thanks to FLEME for having me on this panel. I love the title of the conference. I think it's a very important thing for us to reflect on once in a while. And I think this was a good opportunity to do that. You know, so like, as I think about my own journey, you know, like most of the students in India, I also come from a very pretty humble background, but the education that I went through, I have, you know, really changed my life. You know, first it was being able to go to IIT, and then, you know, being able to go abroad to study at a place like Berkeley, Stanford, and so forth. You know, it completely changed my life. You know, so I was in Silicon Valley as a venture capitalist, and you know, I moved back to India because I really wanted to have impact. You know, I didn't know at that time, you know, how I would have the impact, but the thing that mattered to me is that I got a lot out of what the country had to offer, and I want to have impact. So I came back. First, I came back as an investor. You know, at that point, I thought that, okay, I'll have impact by bringing capital into the country. You know, and then after a few years, as I got more exposure, I got introduced, and as I saw more about the education system in India, I realized that me and people like me are actually a relative minority. You know, people who actually had education that transformed their life. Most people are actually not as fortunate. And I also saw that, you know, everyone was, you know, kind of always pointing out that our graduates are not employable. You know, there's a big gap between what industry wants and, you know, what our education system is producing. You know, Professor Patwardhan alluded to some of these aspects, that the way things were, you know, 10, 15, 20 years back. So I think that got me passionate about education, and I realized that there's no better way to have impact than through education. And that's why in 2009, late 2009, you know, I kind of took the plunge into education. And for me, the sole purpose of doing that is to actually solve the quality problem. You know, and the idea is that, you know, everyone who is willing to put in the effort, who wants to learn, should have access to quality education, right? Because that is what really changes lives. That is what really not just changes your life, it changes your family's life, and it changes your, you know, generations after that, right? And we've seen that, you know, over and over again. You know, my kids are having a very different life because of the education that I got, right? And their life is very different than the life my parents have had, right? So, and that's the power of education. So I think, so first the Great Lakes, you know, I helped build Great Lakes. Today it is one of the top business schools in India, you know, but, you know, that was not enough because, you know, in a physical setting, in a campus-based setting, there's only so much impact you can have. You know, the number of students that you can have an impact on is limited. So, you know, kind of always knew that. And that's where the background that I had in technology. So I had built a company in Silicon Valley, you know, and my background is in technology before coming back to India. So that's what I was able to draw on to actually then create Great Learning, where the idea is to have, you know, universal access to quality education, you know, to really serve that purpose of quality education for anyone who is willing to put in the effort and who's, you know, who wants to, you know, benefit from quality education. So that's what we've been doing over the last 8 years now. You know, we have delivered over 50 million hours of online learning. And the changes that are happening are very interesting and very exciting. You know, online education, you know, thanks to all of the things that has been done by, you know, our regulators and the government, has been brought into focus, and I think a lot more students are going to have access to quality education in the years ahead, you know, and hopefully, you know, it's a hard problem, but over the next 10 years, 20 years, hopefully we can get to that state where everybody will have access to quality education. Thank you.
Lovely. I think, you know, these are two things I'll be coming back to you, quality and technology. As in, I think it kind of pretty much sets a ground for a lot of conversations that we're going to have later too. I would now move on to Mayank. I see some parallels of investment to setting up your own with Mohan, you know, with you. But I would now want you to take me through your journey.
No, thanks, Ajit. I think in hindsight, yes, I can call it the purpose. But I agree to what Shreyasi said, that it did happen to me through serendipity. I got into education more as an accident than a conscious choice. So I've been in education now over a decade now, looking at education first as a advisor, then as an investor. Maybe it's important to tell the story, Sajid, because sometimes there's a lot in the story which leads you to where you are and what you have done. And for me, this was having looked at larger education companies. So I worked with Dr. Patwardhan a long time back when the Manipal sort of ecosystem was sort of scaling up. I looked at education sector and looked at investing in education space, but could not find great companies to back. And that was a bit of frustrating scenario that you did a lot of work, but you were still not finding great assets to back up. And there was one incident, which is what I would share perhaps to bring back the purpose, very similar to what Mohan mentioned, to what Shreyasi said as well. There's this place in north, in Delhi, called Greater Noida. And I jokingly say that if you throw a stone, you will hit an engineering college. There are so many engineering colleges built in Greater Noida. And this was one trip that I took from Delhi to Greater Noida to meet one engineering college. It was a four-storied building. I entered, I asked the guard, look, is there, what happens inside? The guard had no clue. He said, sir, log aate hain, jaate hain, and I don't know what sort of is happening. I went in, the building was empty. And on the third floor, there were four kids doing a BTEC in one of the circuit engineering, electrical, electronics, or computer science, the BTEC program. And I was laughing that, look, the guard doesn't know, the kids are here, there's no faculty member, there's no teacher out there. And suddenly that laughing turned into a penny dropping moment for me, because I then realized that, look, if this is what we are saying as quality of education, then yes, there are multiple challenges, and I can sit on the outside and continue to critique it, saying, look, things are bad, things are not going the way we would like it to go. But if you had had so much understanding of the education sector, if you have looked at education sector from that close quarters, I was part, fortunately enough, Sajid was part of close to $1 billion flowing into the education sector prior to that. But if I'm not doing anything, unfortunately, I don't have the right to complain. And I went with that thought process. And as Mohan mentioned, I was, I'm a product of a highly subsidized education system that this country had to offer. I studied from Kendriya Vidyalaya, I paid 5 rupees a month. When it went to 5 to 15 rupees a month, there was a huge hue and cry as to how can you take the fee from 5 rupees to 15 rupees a month. And then there was this IIT education, which was subsidized. But having gone through this piece, it was always at the back of the mind that, look, if you have gone through the system and if you are pissed about the system, then please do something about it. And that's how the journey of UpGrad started, more than any other thing that I can say in hindsight. And then lastly, Sajid, on in terms of what we want to do, how we want to do, keeping the numbers aside, I still believe that technology and education and quality, the two words that we use, technology and quality coming together. And when we started off, we were very clear that, look, there's a lot of things broken. And one big thing that was broken was about that every place, EdTech was looked at as making content accessible. But that to us was not the problem. And how do we bring in the human touch element along with the technology? That yes, content is there, but what do we do with technology that human element can come in that can solve for problem at scale is what we at UpGrad are trying to do with multiple programs, multiple courses and offering them out there. But that in a nutshell was the story. Now I can say that was a purpose, but at that point in time, it was just an accident.
Interesting. You know, like I said, we would want to kind of go back to the two thoughts of technology and quality. And I think the other important thing that I would want to focus on is what Dr. Patwardhan said is the purpose of education itself. What really is the purpose of education? So if we look at, you know, certain aspects which get spoken about, is education really mainstreaming, making nearly everyone a replica of the other? Or is education just about employability? Or is education about how to live or what's an enriching life? Or it can be many of these things. You know, I would just want to, you know, a few thoughts on this. And if I can go to Dr. Patwardhan first. Sir, I would want you to.
Yeah, it's very interesting discussion that is happening, you know, and the first question which you have raised, I would say that a purpose of education, there are two parts, you know, or three parts rather. The first part is general education. And I feel that that general education should be given to everyone who is supposed to be educated. So educatedness, we have to define what educatedness means. And so that is first general education. Second is professional education. Third is vocational skills. But unfortunately, we are really mixing up all these things. As far as the education purpose is concerned, I see that there are four main categories, you know, which I can talk of purpose. The first purpose is obviously academic, which talks about intellectual strength, general knowledge, scientific temper, self-reliance, interdisciplinary exposure, aptitude, independent thinking, reasoning ability, habit of learning. You know, these are all academic parts. And second part is moral and spiritual values, because I feel that academic alone, what we think as academic is not complete. You know? Because unless you have emotional maturity, ethical values, the simple living, selfless service, humility, truthfulness, dignity of labor, high moral character, these are also should be the attributes which education should really provide. And the third part of that is social sensitivity. Social sensibility in terms of national culture and heritage, tolerance for diversity, national integration, you know, understanding our own country, you know, rural life, how people, what are the agonies of our farmers, you know, classless and casteless society, the political system, the economic system, social forces, the civic sense, the respect for rights, you know, duties and discharge of obligations. You know. And the last part is obviously quality of education. So these are the four purposes which I would put in. And I would say that these should be common to any kind of education. Whether you are doing MBBS or we are doing BTech or you are doing BA and BCom. Unfortunately, the BA, BCom, BSc, where majority of our students are going, you know, the purpose is completely lost there. Why and what I'm doing? These are the questions. If we ask, we really have no answer. So we have to completely change our curricular system. Completely change our curriculum system and inculcate the and connect it with basic purpose of education so that the educatedness becomes cutting across phenomena irrespective of what discipline you come from. And again, anyway, I'll stop here, but about the employability and education connection, I will come later when that point comes on table. Thank you.
Surely. Thank you. This was extremely, you know, very comprehensive to listen to how very nicely you have put it across on not that to be looking at all of education as one and figuring out what fits in where and what the outcomes of each of them are. I would want to now pass on this important question to the other panel members too. If I can come to you, Mayank.
Yeah, no, I think I do believe that education is very difficult to package into various sort of outcomes that the education could provide, because it's a much far-reaching outcome. Because I mean, when people ask me what did I learn from engineering, while I did learn the concepts of mechanical engineering and how things get applied in various contexts, I think the biggest thing that I learned from that four-year stint was A, problem solving, B, working in teams, C, going out and sort of tackling real life situations and coming out with some kind of practical solution. Those things, unfortunately, were not course material. So there was no 4-credit course which said, let's do problem solving. There was no 3-credit course which said, let's do teamwork. And I think there's a lot of talk that goes on about the relevance of degrees. Is degrees relevant or not? I come from the school of thought, Sajid, where I believe that there's a lot of ground foundational work that happens in the garb of what we call degrees. At the back end, there's a lot of foundational work that ends up actually going through in the minds of the learners, which we don't get to see because there's no course such as BA in problem solving. There's no such course as BSc in communication, etc. That particular piece, because it's not shown as part of, it's not front facing, but it is at the back end, is sometimes that it gets missed quite a lot. I'll just leave with one pointer, which is my son is now going through that online learning. And I mentioned this earlier also that I used to think that online learning will actually bring him in a lot of knowledge about math, reading, writing, arithmetic, etc. But one of the things that I'm realizing the value of an offline classroom was to ensure that this kid can sit in a seat for 8 hours straight. Unfortunately, in an online learning setting, that does not end up happening. And it was designed keeping in mind the workforce of tomorrow, that the workforce will have to work in a factory for 8 hours straight. But there are a lot of hidden meaning of education, which unfortunately I'm not able to decipher, but it does a lot beyond just giving the skills, giving employability, giving the next job. Unfortunately, when it comes to paying money for education, those are the conversations that we revolve around. We don't end up saying, what are the other elements that education offers, which in the long term pays huge amount of dividend, but it's difficult to sort of pinpoint that, look, this is what you're doing at this point in time.
Interesting. You know, that kind of will lead me to the next on, you know, is online learning, you know, how is it inferior, superior? There are quite a few viewpoints, but we'll reach there. And I want, you know, because all my panelists to focus on the purpose of education itself. If I can come along to you, Mohan, next.
Yeah, no, in fact, you know, I 100% agree with what Professor Patwardhan said. You know, the true purpose of education has to be that, right? Before you can become employable and capable of certain skills, you have to first be educated. right? So which is the cognitive, the values, and you know, the awareness of the environment around you, the social world around you. All of those are super important. I feel, you know, somehow where it, you know, where the issue really arose is that, you know, these aspects have not been, you know, valued enough by the various stakeholders, right? Like the way, you know, Dr. Patwardhan explained just now, I don't think, you know, most stakeholders in the education system actually, you know, say it like that. Somehow the value has been placed on things that get you a job. Right. And like you said, that's what people end up paying for. So you know, and ultimately it comes down to what are all the stakeholders believing and thinking. And that includes, you know, faculty in institutions, that include, you know, administrators, that include parents, you know, who are sending their kids to school, and then the kids themselves. Right. So, you know, how will they actually appreciate all these things if they, you know, if the spotlight is not put on those things? In fact, if you look at the recruiters, the best companies, they exactly value these things. You know, the cognitive aspects that Professor Bhushan talked about, you know, like problem solving, you know, dealing with adversity, working in teams, all of, you know, those kinds of things. That's what the learnability, that's what actually the best organizations look for, you know, because they believe that if you have those abilities, you can actually pick up the other things that you need. And anyway, those things are going to keep changing, you know, very frequently and all through. You know, so I think it'll be, you know, I think slowly but surely the focus on those aspects is already happening. Okay, now when the labels will change, you know, when you'll actually have courses the way Mayank is talking about, you know, so something that is, you know, termed in these meta terms instead of just giving you like, you know, C++ programming, which everybody tries to do, or like Java programming, you know. So for example, in Great Lakes, you know, as long back as 8 years or 9 years back, you know, we explicitly introduced a course called personal effectiveness. Okay, you know, and you know, and we put it there because we realized that there was no time otherwise that is being spent on this. And personal effectiveness was all about self-awareness, knowing what your strengths and weaknesses were, right, and figuring out what you wanted, you know, getting you to consciously think about what you wanted and what steps you are taking to, you know, to get there. Similarly, we had another course that we introduced, which was basically around problem solving, right? So these programs, you know, given that there is some flexibility that we had in terms of, you know, what courses we could have, these were courses that were introduced, and they were introduced as compulsory courses that everybody had to go through those. So I think today, given the flexibility that the education system has gotten, I think the system today is much more flexible than what we had 15, 20 years back, right? Mm-hmm. These kinds of things are already coming. Even in the K-12 education, right? The various boards, first of all, our international boards already recognize this. And I think increasingly the Indian boards are recognizing this as well. The national boards for sure. And I think, you know, over a period of time, the state boards will as well, where they are going to recognize the importance of these aspects. Right. And hopefully that will result in overall awareness, mm-hmm. You know, and we do have to have these things before the focus is there on employability. Having said that, you know, we still are a poor country yet. And people looking at it are looking at education as the ticket out of poverty, as the ticket, you know, to economic independence and growth. Right. So we cannot take away that aspect of it. Right. So the education system really has to create a balance of these two things. And I hope we will get there sooner rather than later.
Right. Very, very interesting points coming along for the next few conversations. I think Shreyasi, with Harappa, when we see there as a particular philosophy as well. So I would want you to take us through the purpose of education and, you know, maybe weave in the Harappa philosophy and how you look at it from that perspective.
You know, I think it's very heartening for me to have heard, obviously, Professor Patwardhan, Mayank, and Mohan, who I'd love to actually introduce Harappa to, because I think that is really the place we're coming from, is our entire curriculum is based on cognitive, social, and behavioral skills. In fact, there were two big decisions we took when we conceptualized and started Harappa. One was that we would not go into technical/domain skills, not because we don't believe they're important. I don't think in education you can be binary to say somebody doesn't need any kind of education or whatever, but we just felt that there was at least more movement on it in an online edtech space than about the kind of curriculum that we're speaking about. And our curriculum on cognitive, social, and behavioral skills is actually categorized into 5 core habits, as we call them, of thinking, and which of course is like using logically mental models, unleashing creativity, learnability, to problem solving, as Mayank was saying, to communication, both acquiring acquisition of information through listening and reading, as well as delivery of it through writing, speaking. How do you work with people? How do you build trust, rich relationships? And our entire habit of 5 skills on personal leadership, which is called LEAD, which is much more about leading self before you can lead change and lead others, right? So I think, and you know, we were talking about the aspect of quality and technology earlier, and we strongly felt that actually these are the skills, as Professor Patwardhan also said, that are so critical for the professional success as well as personal growth of an individual, and impact the efficiency and productivity of the teams, groups, and organizations that they find themselves in, but have not been teased out, like Mayank was saying. I think great education will, as a consequence, give you some of these problem solving, teamwork, collaboration, introspection skills. But because they've not been put up front and center, they don't get that kind of focus and attention. And we actually decided to just focus on that. And I think, and you know, our conviction is that these are so open architecture. So why wouldn't in MBS you learn about listening? Why wouldn't in MBBS you learn about establishing trust, which is a course you have? Why wouldn't in MBBS you listen, you do a course on reasoning logically, which has mental models, heuristic and biases, or on making decisions, because your decisions are so, as lawyers, why wouldn't you have these skills, right? So we feel that the Harappa skills are important, not just to get a job. And I think the whole thing, it's such a loaded question about the purpose of education. I think I agree with Bohan here that, you know, there is a Maslow's hierarchy almost of education. There's literacy, numeracy, and basic reading at the bottom, right? And then you move up to acquire some basic information that you need, you know, to class 6 arithmetic, like some things that you can do so you can add, subtract, some understanding of the world, where how gravity works or whatever. And then as you keep going up, I think what happens is we don't weave them in together with all of the other skills. So I think it becomes so binary, your focus, so that when you're focused on doing, I don't know, some computer programming, that's all you'll do. For a great data scientist, you know, please go ahead and do a course on, Mayank and I were on another panel just 3 or 4 days back, is please go ahead and do on Great Lakes or Great Learning. I would love to send any Harappa learner to any of these courses. Do that. Do your data science, business analytics, digital marketing, but come and do Decoding Others, which is based on our course, which is based on Daniel Goldman's emotional intelligence. Do the course on leading self, which you also need, right? So I think we self-identify too early as adults that this is what we will do and this is what we need, and therefore lose the balance. So I think very important to understand the Maslow's hierarchy. And the one sad thing, which I think VCs and investors in education in India, as well as entrepreneurs, and everyone, when we come to the technologies, honestly, the largest companies are exam tech rather than them being ed tech, right? And I think there is a certain, I think, introspection that's demanded into saying, in terms of online, what are the things that are happening? And the last point to say, the purpose of education and learning exists beyond 22 and 23, till where we stop all conversations of education, that you're a bachelor's, master's. You know, there's a whole concept of living a centurion life that many of us will go on to live till 100. You know, how will we occupy our minds and brains? And there is something called the 60-year curriculum, that if you are going to live till 100, you'll have 60 years as a professional. And obviously then what you were taught by 21 or 22 is irrelevant. So I think education also has to move into learning. So I think what's exciting for all of us here, there's so much to do and so many things and perceptions and ideas to shape, which is why, I guess, why we're purposeful here.
Interesting. You know, now let me open it up for everyone and throw in a view which, you know, might counter some of, you know, what's being stated. Is online education actually inferior while there is a thought that, you know, we are trying to bring in more quality via online education, there is a parallel, especially with the pandemic and, you know, a lot of people going along. And I think one of the examples Mayank gave as well, is it that online education does not fulfill many of the aspects that maybe traditional schools do and traditional universities do? While we look at them as broken, they might not as such be as broken. And feel free now to, you know, I would like to throw it open to the panel here to come in and share your views on, is online education inferior, or it can be looked at from the other side, is it superior? Because the premise has been that quality and technology means definitely better. I'm questioning it.
So should we just take it up one by one?
Yeah, you go ahead.
Because I said it, my kids' example, and let me just start off with that, because at least I may be partly the culprit of putting that question out. So Mohan, Shreyasi, and Dr. Patwardhan, apologies, because we all are propagating online education. But here's my point of view on this one. When we started off, Sajid, our take was very clear that we want online education to be better, if not, I mean, as good as offline, if not better than the offline education system. And there are multiple reasons. And the reason I say this is, the point I raised was that it is actually the way you look at online education as to what problem are you solving for, is when you will realize that, are you building a system which is better or worse than offline ecosystem? If you are looking at online education of connecting you to the best faculty members, then you are not solving for the problem of education. If you're looking at education as giving access to the best content, then you're not solving for the problem of education. Education as such, and I sort of internally to my product team and my learning team, I say, look, we come with an extreme amount of disadvantage to the offline ecosystem. In offline ecosystem, I'm inside four walled corners. So if a teacher has to communicate something to me, I better nod my head, because I cannot run out of the door because I'm just in that closed four-door corner. In online education, you don't have that corner. So if you are trying to solve for the problem of education, at least put a blinker between the person's eyes and the person's laptop or the computer, and create an environment around that so that the person does not move out of that environment. So to the way we look at it, Sajid, and the point is that, look, I can bring in best faculty members, I can bring in best content, I can bring in the best experts to come and teach you, I can bring in the best coach to guide you. But that is not education if I can bring in the most amount of discipline and a distraction-free learning environment. I think we have won the game. And that is the fight that online education has to make. It's not about great content. And I genuinely feel, I mean, I can build really good content, but it's not going to move the needle unless I can bring in a sense of discipline and a rigor, because what I'm fighting for is four-wall distraction-free environment, which is difficult to bring in online education. So that's my take, that I don't look at evaluation right now. I think one should look at it as how you're looking at solving the problem. And if you're solving the problem with that angle, you will definitely end up building something better than offline, because offline comes with inherent advantages, which online does not at this point in time.
Sure. Would you share?
Let me come here quickly. You know, Miss, I think we have a lot of confusion about this online education terminology itself. You know, there is nothing like online, offline. I think education for the purpose, you know, the future education is going to be blended in any case. You know, there cannot be 100% online, there cannot be 100% classroom based. So I would take you to the basic issue of pedagogy in education. When you talk about what are you trying to do, you know, that I go back to our own traditional way to look at, I'm not talking about Bloom's taxonomy, you know. I know Bloom's taxonomy, but the very simple term, Adidhi, Bodha, Acharan, and Pracharana, these are the four things which we have been following in our Gurukul system. Now look at this, Adidhi is information and theory. Information giving, I think information giving can go 100% online, you know. There is MOOC, there is whatever it is. You don't need teacher to give you notes. Earlier, teacher's note was their power, you know. Today, it has become liability. That is outdated. Today's students are much smarter. So I don't want any teacher to come and give boring PowerPoints. You know, I call it as death by PowerPoint. You know, what are we doing? So we don't need for that purpose. You know, both the understanding and analysis, gaining knowledge, deeper awareness, understanding principles, theory, comprehension, analysis, where teacher will have to change its role only of one-way dialogue, but get engaged with students. We are undermining capabilities of the students. The future learning is co-learning. We have to bring students. Today also I learn from my students every day. You know, we completely monopolize, teachers have monopolized teaching, you know. So this is not the way in which future is going to go. So acharana, you have to actually practice performance, practice, you know, use acquired knowledge, test principles, experiment, practice. You know, this is what will happen in laboratories. It cannot happen online, you know. No matter what powerful tools and techniques you bring in with artificial intelligence or graphics or any other technologies, you know, you bring in virtual or whatever, you know, it is not possible. So this online education has definite place, but for what purpose we have to decide, you know. If we say that I will give you 100% online degree of medicine, you know, I think we will be contributing to population problem of our country. So, but at the same time, we'll say that no, we are going to teach biochemistry theory as we used to teach 10 years, 20 years ago, even today, when students have access to all the information through good MOOCs program, we are wasting our time inside the classroom. You know, we don't need that. Mm-hmm. So we have to bring the balance and we have to bring in a new model of blended pedagogy.
I agree with Sajit, if I can come in. I completely agree with that. I think to say something as binary is online learning good, inferior, superior, I think isn't an important conversation, because what choices, and as a country, what choices do we have if we don't have from niche, great, offline only institutions of repute, research, academic brilliance, plus you need technology-enabled solutions and educational initiatives that can go for scale, that can come and complement, bridge. I think some of the ones that we were saying, if you had 10 amazing faculty who could teach the theory part of it to everyone, imagine. And you know, where are you going to get all the teachers in an offline? So I think neither is a, we really don't have a choice. I think we have to find a way to do what together, and online for whom, online for what. And I think he was talking about the academic red bank or the NEP or this whole thing about lifelong learning that we will come in. The fact is there are some things you will do which is just asynchronous online, because that's all you need if you wanted to go and do a course, I don't know, on nutrition so that you could live a better life. You might not want to leave your job or anything and go and do whatever. As an entrepreneur, if you start doing, you know, somebody who does not know, I don't want something on finance or legal or IP that's important for your business, you might want to do a refresher course online. For some things where you want to build depth and expertise, you will do a fully offline with a great faculty, and that's what you would look for. So I think the real power is about many formats for many different users at many times in your life as a student learner and as a professional. And I think online learning is a very, very essential addition to those formats to be able to make that available as a choice for all of us.
Mohan, just to, you know, you come where you are a part of a physical education space and online education space. I would want you to, you know, ponder on and tell me on this particular question that, you know, can all those courses in the physical space go online for you, or online can come physical? How do you make those choices? And this thought that everything will coexist and a particular ideal can happen, how does it kind of work out? And maybe, you know, handling both those, you might be having a different or a new view.
Absolutely. You know, I'll share my perspective. It's, you know, broadly similar to what other panelists have also mentioned. So first of all, online versus offline, you have to completely look at it in context, right? So what education are we talking about, right? If you talk about, you know, kindergarten and early age kids, right? Online will be a disaster. Best it will be, it can be entertainment for them. You know, they just, I don't think online will support that, you know, anything more than an auxiliary, you know, edutainment kind of thing, right? At the same time, if you talk about like working professionals, right? And, you know, for them, something like online would be a boon. In fact, you know, that would be the only feasible thing, because most of them will not have the luxury of, you know, taking time off from their work. So first of all, who is the learner and what is the learning challenge that we are looking to solve, right? So that that context is what's going to decide whether online is better or offline is better. So I think, you know, very important for us to recognize that. Second is, even, you know, within the various learner segments, you know, where, like Professor Patwardhan said, what is it that you're trying to actually, you know, learn or teach? That is also going to decide, you know, whether digital or, you know, in-person thing makes a difference. So communication of information is best than online. No two ways about it, right? It is the other aspects, which is that, you know, there are problems which are, let's say, completely subjective, where it is all about, you know, sharing of opinions and then figuring out how to, you know, only where discussions are the way to learn, right? That is very difficult to do online.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But if you're looking at just problem solving, if you're trying to basically look at, you know, learning a concept and then applying it and then, you know, learn, that is something that can be done online. You can have, you know, somebody coach you, guide you online. So all of those things can be done. Right. So it completely depends on what is it that you're trying to learn also. Right. And I believe that is what the future is going to look like. Even. Okay. So let me draw it from kind of an age perspective. Right. The younger you are, the more important a role on offline is going to play, you know, because there it is not just about the, you know, subject matter that you're trying to learn. There are important life skills that you're trying to learn as well. All the other things that we talked about, right? And those are very difficult to be, you know, encapsulated, you know, and organized in an online setting, pure online kind of setting, right? So the younger you are, the more important a role that offline is going to play. And as you get older, I think online will stand a better chance of serving your needs and meeting. So because online also gives you a lot of advantages. For example, the kind of personalization you can do online, you cannot do offline, right? The kind of tracking, you know, interventions and course corrections that you can do online, that is not possible offline. Like the amount of diagnostics that you get, the amount of information that you get in an online setting is far superior to what you get, you know, in an offline setting. So there are things that you, you know, you, that that online enables you to do. There are things that I saw a great example of this, and I think it's a sign of things to come. You know, Microsoft created this VR model, you know. So imagine that you're learning about, as a medical student, you're learning about the heart, right? And you're learning about surgery and you're learning about, so, you know, here is a VR model where you can actually walk into a heart. Okay. You can, you know, have a view where you're inside the heart and you can actually look around and see how it looks like inside, how various parts are, you know, interacting with each other and what happens if you do something, right? Now, do you call that offline or online, right? I'm standing in a certain setting. And, you know, I could be on campus, I'm standing, and then I'm actually using VR to go do something, right? You know, that is completely use of technology. So, you know, I just stepping back,
mm-hmm.
there are online or offline being better is completely context dependent. Mm-hmm. Who is the learner? What is it that is being learned? And, you know, like, what is the purpose of, you know, that learning that we are trying to solve? That is what's going to decide whether online or offline is better.
Interesting.
Sajit, I just want to add one thing, and I think you probably meant it from, you probably meant it asking us this question from the last 10 months and 11 months of experience, right? And I think to that, my thing is the biggest advantage that the last 10, 11 months has done, and these are very unfortunate reason for it to happen, is the fact that every educator, every education administrator, every student, every learner of all kind has at least been exposed to online, other than obviously the access and inequity of access issues, right? I'm not disregarding that, but in terms of a large portion, I think that's really important for the innovation. That adoption has given the trigger for all the experimentation that will happen. Otherwise, that level of adoption in a condensed 10-month period of a system that has been existing for, you know, decades and centuries would never, ever have happened. So I think sort of, you know, my it's, I'm very optimistic that having experienced it and every, so many people's experiences being subpar, disillusioning, underwhelming, will only trigger progress on an improvement of the experience. And you know, we are really, like I keep saying, and I think I said this in another panel that I was saying to Mayank and I were just 2 days back or whatever, is we really at, even before the black and white of the online learning, right? And things will get better also in online learning and won't stay what they are, which is let's meet on Zoom.
If I may just add just one point here, you know, see, it's not as if in offline, it's all the same, right? You have good offline education and bad offline education and the entire spectrum in between. Exactly like that, it will be for online as well. There'll be good online education, there'll be bad online education and everything in between. So I think that's something we have to keep in mind as well. It's not a, you know, binary.
Interesting. Now we'll go a bit, you know, quick on the round of answers as we have a few minutes and very important things to share and discuss from the audience too. So the first part for the panel here is that where is the human element here? Like, you know, I got to a very, you know, in a way interesting or contrasting views. Dr. Patwardhan said that, you know, the teaching fraternity maybe kind of, you know, hold it while Mohan said that, you know, it could be personalized via analytics and feedback about the person's performance in a much better way. But isn't it a lot more easier for a human being out there in a classroom to be able to do that? Is it online that is better? And where is this human element there? And maybe from some of the fraternity here, that what is the teacher's role? Is the teacher just a performer? You know, maybe a content creator as such, maybe it might be a better performer might be out there who can actually create content, or even content of the manner that Mohan said, you know, could be future, like walking into a heart and those kind of systems. So where is this human element of teaching learning in this whole scenario?
I think I can give some example from Upgrad itself, Sajid, that when we're doing this learning, and I don't think it would be any different to what Mohan would do at Great Learning, that and what Professor Patwardhan mentioned also, that content is being provided in the form of video lectures, PPTs, presentation, et cetera, et cetera. But there's a lot of focus that all of us do in terms of one-on-one coaching, one-on-many coaching. So that's where a coach comes in, a faculty comes in and tries to sort of delivers that learning to the learner and solves the problem. So I think when we're talking about online education, there's a lot of human touch that comes in. Where technology helps is that interaction can be far more personalized. So I'm going to have an interaction with Mohan where I will focus on saying, look, when you're closing on the Python code, you are always messing up with the last sort of end code and on the iteration code. While for Shreyasi, it could be very different that, look, you're done, you're doing the code really well, but your articulation is not the best. So the coach comes in with that system-driven responses, which are very personalized to the individual. Otherwise, when I'm sitting in a classroom of 35 students or 50 students, I will have to bucket them. And then I will have to tell in buckets saying, okay, for some of these guys, this is what matters. But in this case, a coach can come here, tell you very, very critically and importantly saying, this is where you're missing up on. So while we have all these things, we have about 1,000 plus coaches and mentors on the platform who are on a consistent basis handholding them. And that is where I feel the online ecosystem will evolve. Someone will write a book, someone will teach that book, and some teaching associates or grader will actually grade and give more personalized feedback. That system is replicable in online as much as it is replicable in offline as well.
Interesting. So in a way, some parts of it can be automated is what I hear if I kind of look at it in another way, while the other part of it is where maybe there is a human element or there is a flexibility of someone coming along and explaining things.
Ajit, I'll put it like this. You know, so let me, you know, say something that I deeply believe in. There is absolutely no substitute to a great teacher. Okay, like a great teacher is like the, you know, the most important thing that can happen to education, right? Unfortunately, great teachers are few and far in between. Okay, if great teachers were available in abundance, then actually, I don't think there would be a problem in the education, you know, sector globally. The challenge is that we don't have enough great teachers. Great teachers who can, you know, intuitively perceive how well students are learning, who have a pulse of what is happening in a classroom setting, who are able to grasp all the needs of the group of students, who are able to dynamically react, you know, to what their needs are, who are able to give intuitive examples that are really helping people understand what's being talked about, who are able to bring in various perspectives. So such people are mind-blowing. Very few. In fact, one of the things that online education, you know, the way we use it is serving is actually extend and magnify the impact of these great teachers, right? So we don't see ourselves as actually replacing great teachers. We see ourselves as expanding the influence and expanding the reach and expanding the magic of great teachers. Okay, because they are few and far in between. Mm-hmm. And really enabling that the great teacher's time is used for the most high value aspects of the learning process. And their time is not spent on the, let's say, things that others can do. Like Mayank talked about, right? Having, you know, let's say when you have doubts, you don't need a Nobel laureate to answer your doubts. There are others that can do that. Okay. Yeah. And this is not different from what happens, let's say, in, you know, the best academic universities, right? The first year introductory courses are typically taught by the best faculty, you know, in large auditoriums where 500 students, 600 students, undergraduates are sitting, right? I remember attending a course like this, in like a biology course at Berkeley taught by a Nobel laureate. Okay. Why do these people teach that? Not because others can't teach it. And it's not as if they are sitting and answering the students' questions. There's almost no interaction. But these people understand the subject so well that they can actually bring out the magic of their subject. At the end of the class, you feel like, oh my God, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. Okay. Inspired, right? Mm-hmm. That's the magic of great teachers. There's not enough of them. That's what technology can do.
Yeah, I'll quickly go on to the next question as we are winding up. And I'll take audience questions right after this. Please use hashtag Flame Purpose Summit and tag in your questions for the speakers. And I'll be asking them those in the next 5 minutes. Just the last one and an important one, especially from the Indian context, we have a very clear education divide based on rural, urban, and also based on, you know, the amount of money and the type of schools that most of the people can go. So on one side, there is this opportunity of online to give, amplify, like you said, Mohan, or give this access via content to a lot more wider audiences. But on the other side is that a lot of wider audiences might not have access to certain kinds of technology in the form of a smartphone or some of those things, which maybe someone who's kind of having a laptop and a tablet and multiple devices can actually make the best use of. So where does online education come in and how can it be looked at? Is it widening the gap or is it can uplift a lot of people who currently do not have that access? I'm opening it, you know, for quick responses.
I'll give a quick response on this. You know, listen, what happened in March and what has happened March 2020, what has happened was there was zero preparation, right? And I think, you know, people could not be equipped. And I think we have to stop comparing only the current and have to build for the future, right? And I think as we have seen in India, I have complete confidence and optimism that we will leapfrog on the fact that there will be more phones, there will be more internet penetration, and we will be able to make some of these learning solutions and learning experiences much more accessible. Are they perfectly accessible now? But who says that 1.5 million schools, you know, 60% of them are two-room shelters, that there is any equity in education even there? So I think we, you know, the fact is that not to say that there isn't an education inequity right now. Of course, there's massive one. Not to say that this overnight jump into online that all educational institutions had to do did not lead to very, very painful and tragic learning outcomes and greater inequity. But over the next 3 years, over the next 5 years, over the next 10 years, what's going to happen is what we need to focus on and fix the current inequities rather than saying because the current inequities exist, we will not go ahead on the path of online, right? Because then that would be very limiting and not useful.
Sure.
Sajid, first, let me admit that this is a problem. Means we have to accept that this is a problem, but this is not a problem of today. This problem we are facing for years, you know, this divide we are facing for years. And digital divide, of course, has been talked quite a lot. I see two things here. One, I will see that future, the robotics will play a major role. social robots. You know, future teaching will be a collaborative teaching wherein teachers and robots will be together. So cobot kind of a situation. Second, to deal with this kind of a divide, I think technology and all of you, you know, all the panelists are here, techies here, I would say that you should think a little differently. Why we are talking only about online, which is available from a computer, you know, or a mobile. Television is such a powerful media, which is there all over the country, you know, even in small places. In Gram Panchayat, at least one television is there. So practically there. So why can't we use some kind of a system to use that powerful model? I remember that Miss, why do you need a computer? I don't understand. You know, there were efforts earlier, you know, we heard a lot of big news, but I don't know what has happened to them later. Why can't we bring a very, very economical gadget? You know, why can't we? Why do you, why I have to use my laptop? I don't need anything, you know, I just need a, and with cloud and everything, my needs of laptop are so limited. I think I am using 90%, which I don't use, I don't need, and which I'm paying for. You know? So Mohan and all of you, you know, you have such a bright minds. You know? You should think about something, you know, why?
Sir, 2 years. 2 years. Give us 2 years.
Thank you. I am very happy to hear that.
And radio. I feel I agree with him. Radio.
Radio also.
Radio is so powerful. It's a mass media.
So we will hold you to that, Mohan. At Flame Purpose Summit 2023, you know, we will come back to you on that.
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I must give you what visionaries see, you know. Thomas Edison, 1923. He said, it is my firm conviction that a large part of education in coming generations will not come by books, but by moving pictures. And here Mayank comes in. I think future education, entertainment, all that should converge. Education cannot sit in corner, you know, and say that we will keep on teaching what we think and what we believe and what happens inside the campus is only academic and only teaching. All those walls are going to get collapsed in future very soon.
Interesting. I'll now go to, quite a few audience questions which have come along for specific speakers as well. So the first question is for Mayank. Mr. Mayank, do you believe the future will see a difference in work situations as education, as you mentioned, because they were designed for long sitting hours? Do you see that, you know, work shifting as well? Has COVID changed working
for you? Yeah, long sitting hours. I was just frustrated with my kid. That's all. But I think broadly speaking, yes, the workforce of tomorrow is going to be very different. I ask this question to everyone joining UpGrad when we do a weekly sort of induction session. I ask them, just give me a number and divide the number of years of experience with the number of jobs that you have had. And everyone puts up 2, 3, 4, 1.5, 1.8. And I ask them the same question, tell the same thing about your parents. And the answer is 30, 40, 29, 80, 18 or 17, et cetera. So I think we are living in an environment where maybe may not be directly answering to your point, but Sajid, the work environments are changing where even what Shreyasi mentioned, Dr. Prapada mentioned, Mohan also mentioned that it cannot be just one and done scenario that once you got a, I don't think that's, what you're learning at the time of graduation till the time when you are at 60 years old or 65, 70 years old, which most of us would be working, things would change significantly. And therefore, you have to go back to injection, get yourself injected once every 5 years, reboost yourself, get upgraded, come back to the workforce and stay relevant. I think that's the most important thing, because I think as much as we have to do it in health, we will have to do the same thing in education as well.
Right. The next question goes to Dr. Patwardhan. I'm just moving on from one to the other. The questions might seem a bit out of sync, but I really want to ensure that everyone who has asked the question gets a voice here via my representation. So, Dr. Patwardhan, does the UGC have plans to have a monitoring or regulatory system or metrics for online courses for ensuring quality of education which is imparted?
Yes, we do have. And it is a lot of things are in making. At the first step, we have converged the regulations of so-called distance and open learning ODL program and online, we have combined. So slowly we are trying to merge everything together. We can't keep this in compartments, you know, because education cannot be compartmentalized. So that is something happening. We are also concerned that online education should not go on the same lines of open and distance learning, where the experience is not very good. You know, it should not get converted into degree mills, and the online degree should not result into some kind of Amazon degree, you know, because in India, we are very good in, you know, making things complicated and using facilities not in a right way. And that is why regulate. Otherwise, I am of the opinion that there should be no regulation. Actually, we at UGC also, we have been trying to deregulate ourselves. So during last 3 years, if you have seen, we have given a lot of things to autonomy, you know, and self-declaration. So why policing? You know, why if somebody defaults, then we can come in. So that kind of approach is now coming in. But at the same time, education is such a thing that if damage happens, you know, the damage effect is long term, and therefore we have to be careful.
I'm moving on to a very different question for Mohan. So much of the application of digital technology in learning has been in the realm of moving lectures from classroom to the internet. Yesterday at the summit, there were sessions on the future of education. Leaders from major liberal arts colleges discussed the importance of community and campus learning. So you mentioned about one part, which is this teacher. But what about the other part, which is the community?
Absolutely. As I mentioned, you know, the suitability of online or the lack thereof is very much dependent on what is it that's being talked about, right? So, you know, if you are in a liberal arts setting and you're actually like, you know, studying and you know, debating history, or if you're debating, you know, civics, right? So it could actually be a very poor experience if you do it in a purely content consumption kind of manner. Right. So therefore, the online education system has to solve for that. OK, so either you have to, you know, simulate that online, or you have to actually have a blended approach where the information dissemination is happening online, but the engagement and the community aspect that you're talking about happens online. Right. And that's really what is, you know, so for example, you know, several of the programs that we offer are actually in blended mode. We've been offering blended programs since 2013. You know, I think we were one of the earliest folks to be doing this globally, not just in India. And that is exactly what is happening, right? So folks are learning, you know, online, consuming information, applying it, and then coming together once a month and actually discussing it. You know, so they are discussing it, they are critiquing each other, they're getting feedback, all of those kinds of things are happening, you know, and that is still, so there'll be many, many models, but yes, there are certain things that lend themselves to better application offline rather than online.
Shreyasi, you know, the last question, I think, you know, which takes on from what, in a way, Mohan was saying about blended, and you had earlier mentioned about, you know, the importance of skills and employability. This question is outside the technical fields of programming management education, which I think Mohan was referring to, you know, most of the courses that are kind of coming along in Great Learning. And some of the other platforms, there isn't much recruitment happening for, you know, which are the kind of skills that are being provided by you. So how do you look at, you know, this is the question, how do you look at that being shifted? Because when someone does a management education, a program or a analytics program, or, you know, a digital marketing program, they know that they're employable. But what about the skill-based program in online?
So, of course, I think that's a great question. Of course, I think there is a greater understanding and evangelizing of skills that and the kind of cognitive social behavior skills that we speak to do. But I think we've been heartened from our Harappa experience that we find more resonance, and whether it's employers, whether it's university administrators, the two, you know, sets of stakeholders who we go and position our programs and our courses to, have actually been very forthcoming. I think in a lot of undergrad engineering and postgraduate MBA, the lack of skills about somebody being able to go get a job because of the degree, and then what do they do? And then sort of the consequence of that, you know, that potential not being unleashed, that disillusionment happening, people feeling upset, is pretty massive and well understood. And I think it's a true travesty that after 16 or 18 years of education, somebody is told that you can't do anything and you're not ready for the workplace after having studied so hard and your parents having taken mortgage and debt and all of that to put you through undergrad and graduate. So I think that understanding of skills is there. I think on the employer side and on the recruiter side, that understanding is actually galloping and accelerating pretty significantly, right? So I think they might not all have the ways to be able to evaluate who comes with what skills and at which proficiency, but the need for the kind of skills that we're talking about, and if somebody had those skills, what that person and how that person can contribute to their teams, is actually pretty well understood in companies. So I think there is a growing understanding of the impact of those lack of skills, and then therefore the focus on helping whether students or employees at the workplace acquire those skills, even without degrees. Because the thing about learning as an adult is, it's not about knowledge, it's about what you can do, right? So it's not about what you know, but what you can do, and skills are very critical for that.
True. Interesting. We are at the last, you know, minute of the panel, and we have been able to take a lot of questions and bring in very interesting points, at least for a lot of our participants who are turned in on to the Flame Purpose Summit. This is a very important aspect, which is education. As everyone has said, it has such a huge impact, over mankind. And for many years, it's a long-term effect. And there is a lot of promise in what UGC is doing, what UpGrad is doing, what Great Learning and Great Leaks is doing, and what Harappa is doing, and we at Flame University are doing ourselves. So there is a lot of promise to see changes. In the last minute, I would just want maybe a couple of words or one line from you about future of education. What's your view, as in where do you see it? A couple of lines about future of education.
So I can take this first. So I'll say I look at it with a lot of optimism, because I feel that
you're trying to get you into a couple of words.
I think, optimism, and there's a lot of dynamism. There's a lot of change that is happening. I think everybody is ready for change now.
Change, optimism, dynamism. Interesting. Let's move on. Mayank?
Future of education to me is phenomenal. I think there's a lot that one will see that we have not even witnessed so far.
So a lot can be done. Interesting. Tracy?
Excitement, urgency, and much needed.
Interesting. Dr. Patwardhan, for the closing note.
I think I made my points, so I will skip that in the interest of time.
Okay. Sure. Thank you. Thanks a lot for a wonderful panel. It was a great interaction that we had. We will now move along to a musical performance by Chirag Kati. Stay tuned to Fame Purpose Summit 2021.